there's a lot to be said about the future in terms of inertia. The future does exist if you let it exist, but you don't have to. You may actually grab it and make of it what you want to be. The future often is a place where the past happens again with a twist. In terms of foresight, sometimes what is important is to be able to capture what should be there and it isn't, because absence makes a difference as much as a presence.
I think one interesting behavior is that many people, although they will tell you that they feel strongly about their privacy and they want it to be protected, then they behave in ways that make you think, do they really think that? They share information online through social networking sites and so on in ways that really then opens up their data to millions or hundreds of millions of people around the world. I think the interesting question is, there's lots of research showing people do genuinely care about privacy, but they just don't understand how to use technology in a way that will protect it. So I think the big question is, how do we design the technology so that people can actually make their privacy preferences real?
We didn't prepare the ground in order to have this technology make sense to the current legal system. The internet came and completely like disrupted initial former legal system and things. And then eventually the system has adapted, but it took a while. And you had like this period of time in which it was like, you know, people thought, oh my God, the internet is going to be anarchy and whatever, right? Eventually, now we all find out that it's not the case and that it's perfectly regulated.
Well, maybe the curious behavior is people's belief that you can organize without the need for intermediaries. I think to some extent it's a slightly problematic belief. For example, in the blockchain community, there's this idea that you can just organize via technology. But there's a seed of something interesting in that belief that you do not need centralized authorities to organize. And I think in the future, that belief will start to get more nuanced and kind of more people will actually work out what they, a sort of more interesting version of that belief.
We can go to the last question, yeah. And it's what you think if we say that the future doesn't exist?
The future doesn't exist, I believe that. The past doesn't exist. The present might exist, but it depends on your kind of philosophical idea. I guess I'm reminded of the William Gibson quote, the future is here, but it's unevenly distributed.
We only live in the present, right? The past is a kind of virtual reality, it's just in our brain. Okay. The future is also is a kind of virtual reality, right? So the only thing that we can definitely say is the present, right?
In a real way, that's the case. but there will be other presents, right? And those presents are actually created now, right? So if you want a different present at some point, where you know inequality is not that big and the nature is not being destroyed, it's right now that you have to think about this and also start doing it. I think the big danger is there's two dangers. One is doing nothing, but the other danger is panic, right? Because there's so many things, there's so many crises coming together, and when you're too much of a doom thinker, you know, there's a fight or flight, right? You can either fight a problem or you can run away from it. But there's another thing that people forget, and it's paralysis. If you're too afraid of the future, then you can't do anything, right? So you have to hurry slowly or, yeah, something like that. Okay. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay, great. Yeah, thank you.